Hey, it's the Chief, bonding with board games. We're looking at Conflict of Heroes. It's a review, Conflict of Heroes, Guadalcanal. First time Academy Games has taken the Conflict of Heroes system into the Pacific. It's a tactical World War II war game. Generally two players. It can scale up to three or four. Basically, you kind of split the forces off. I almost always play two player. Game's going to run, I think the intro ran us 45 minutes, but the intro is short, generally a couple hours, which for me is the sweet spot right where I want it. You got to have enough time to maneuver, but I don't like these going so long that I can't finish a game in an evening. Let me go in, show you a closer look, show you the rules, and I'm going to even show you a little bit of the more than basic rules, because I think it shines a little bit higher than what the basic setup is. But I'll show you that, and we'll come back, and I'll give you my full review. All right, for those that haven't seen it, this is Steve Pashal's art. He does all the art for the box covers for all the Conflict of Heroes series, and just love the action. He's always got a style where the further they are, kind of the... It looks almost like they're moving harder, or that your focus is clearly on the guy that's about ready to hurt you. And it makes things feel like they're alive. So, enough of that. Let's go in. It's not an unboxing, so let me step away, and I will show you first kind of how the... By the way, this is the Army expansion. I've not played with the Army guys. But I'll show you exactly how these work, and we'll get in tight on the maps, and I'll show you something there that's a little concerning. But let me tighten up. Okay, gorgeous map, right? You can see this. This is the most beautiful map. I'm going to show you some of the other ones here in a little bit too, but this one describes some of the visual problems I have the best. Again, it's a gorgeous map. Let me zoom in, and I'll show you a few details. All right, so these are the palm groves. This is a palm grove here. And you can see kind of how your hexes are mostly defined by the corner piece. They kind of fade out, which is fine. And in the sand, you can pick up these hexes pretty darn easy. But let me kind of move over, and you can see as we get into... this kanai grass, I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing it right. You can see it kind of like, again, I can pick up my edge here, but you almost kind of lose it in here. At least I do. And this is just the grass. Now we're getting into light jungle, and I'm looking at it through my viewfinder, and I can't really see the... Here I can pick one up, but I can't really see them in here. And I don't really... see any center dots. But let me move out. So again, we come in and we've got the grass, and I can kind of pick them up and everything's fine. But now we're going to move into this. Maybe that was even heavy jungle. It moves from light jungle to heavy jungle in there. So this is heavy jungle. This is lighter jungle. So you can see how they lighten up the palette a little bit. And I mean, it's just very hard to see these little hexes. Now again, the maps are gorgeous, but this is where some of the functionality lost for me. Now I'm going to do something here to kind of show you a comparison. Again, I love this map. I love the look of the map. I'm going to take you back to the very first Conflict of Heroes map, and you can just see how it was done. The artwork is not... I mean, the artwork on this Guadalcanal map is almost photorealistic. I feel like I'm looking at a photo. Again, all the map boards are high quality. So this is the very first game board. And you can just see the buildings and everything. And you can see there's the full overlay. So everything's a little easier to see. But you can definitely see what I call the chicken wire. So again, great, but you can see kind of the difference. Now, Price of Honor comes out, and the maps, this one has a little bit of a linen finish, and it's a little rough to the touch, They came out in Price of Honor, which is the all the battles in Poland. Again, a gorgeous map. And it was as if the artwork was just tweaked up a little bit. The shading that you kind of have, instead of just everything being green, the trees looked a little bit better. The way they worked the shading, even in the plowed fields. But everything's essentially, the buildings maybe done up a little bit nicer with some detail. But the color palette was kind of warmed up a little bit. But let me get this one out of here because I'm going to show you the second printing of Awakening the Bear, which is what this is from. And it's I'm going to show you the exact same map. Now, I've done a video where I show this, but you can see when they get into this photorealism, let me make sure I orient them the same way. Okay. So, same map. You can see the difference with these two buildings. So it's the same building, same terrain, same even circular drive. But this is where Academy Games started doing the photorealism and they changed the hexes. Now you can see all the hexes great in here. Maybe a little bit harder when you get into the woods, but they did a very interesting thing. You can tell the woods are kind of artificially almost in a hexagon kind of shape. They kind of break out of it a little bit, but it was very easy to tell. I never struggled with it. But you can see the improvement that's been made. This new map is way better. So I love the photorealism. But I almost feel like maybe the lines in here needed to be lightened up a little bit, maybe, or I don't know. So, all right, I've showed you some. Let me show you the other maps because there's some other real cool innovations here. When they came in with the photorealism, they showed the hills in a kind of a more real way as well. I don't have one with the map. They used to just be color ranges, and it didn't look like a real hill. These do, but I want to show you, let me fold this so I can get it in here. If you see these little triangles, they're actually telling you the elevation of the hill. So this is a one elevation hill. This is ground level. One elevation up, two elevations, still two. Now you're into a three elevation height. So they've added a little, this is new. The other one had the same photorealism kind of stuff, but you didn't have this little aid to tell you what height you were at. So clearly there must have been some complaints maybe on the past Awakening the Bear maps that the hills were a little harder to distinguish, and they added this. So again, love the maps. This is another gorgeous map. And this one, you're not quite as lost again. You can tell when you're in the jungle, but it kind of holds to the format. And there's just more sparse jungle, so it's not nearly as hard to pick up those hexes. I'll show you another one. There's only four maps in this one. Some of the other Conflict Vero games featured five, but there are these beautiful overlays that I'm going to show you that allow you to really trick everything out. And I love the idea of four base maps that are huge, by the way. These are huge maps with the overlays coming in. So I love, again, the palm groves, sandy. You've got a lot of light jungle, a little bit of heavy jungle. You can see how the artwork really lends itself to it. And I'll show you this last map, and then I'll show you the overlays. Again, we have hills. Let me show it to you this way. This one feels to me, obviously, very similar. I mean, you can tell they're different. I wanted to show you real quick. But heavy jungle, the grass, river running through it, and the hills. And again, the little helper guides that tell you the elevation. So I love what they did there. Now, let me show you a few of these overlays. I'm just going to throw them down on here. All right, we got some buildings. Just built up areas. Other side, some light jungle. You got a little bit of a marshy kind of area, a little bit of water. Again, heavy jungle, I believe. All right, there's actually a river connection that you'll make in one of the scenarios. Elevation. Here's the other piece of the river deal. It goes right down to the beach. And there's kind of a bigger one with a hill on it. And then a built-up village kind of area. I love these because it really allows for the firefight scenarios, the individual little fights that you do, to be varied up and changed a lot with just four boards. It definitely takes the four base boards and feels like you can turn them into, you know, something that feels like six. There's just ways to tweak them out. I like that. All right. It's a lot on the maps, but I wanted to show you it because that is, and I'll cover it more in my final thoughts. It's one of my bigger criticisms. Conflict of Heroes rulebook. If you played any of the games, you're going to get exactly what you would expect. I'm going to do this really quick, but I'll just explain. There's tons of great information in here. You get designer's notes. You get examples listed in red. There's a kind of like a tab system, so they're not really tabbed, but they tell you where you're at, what sections you're in. And then the way the firefights work, and I'll show you this in a second, the way the firefights work are in conjunction with the rules. So you can read up to, I think it says section, I think they call them sections or something. Let me go through. So you got all your elevation. Yeah, so section 2 brings in the Bushido stuff. And so you're going to play the first scenario, and you don't have to, you, by the way, tons of great history. So when you go to play your first firefight, you only need the rules that have been covered up to this. You don't need section 2 yet. You don't have artillery. That's coming. You don't have tanks. Also coming. You don't have mortars. You're not using any of the cards, the command cards that are in the game. You're not using Bushido yet. And so you've got the basic rules to go play a basic firefight. And then, okay, you've learned that. That worked really easy. You can read into section 2. Then you got section 3. And it just starts to add in flares now. And we've got smoke. And here's our artillery. And section 5, now you're getting into your hills. So they're going to feed you the hills. By the way, you got bunkers and you got foxholes and you got wire. Snipers are coming in section 4. And so it runs you through these five sections. You get some great designer notes. And it even gives you, you know, you can do, they mentioned like how to solitaire it. You're basically playing from both sides. But that is how the rules work in conjunction with the firefights. Now you're going to see they do some real nice things where you can go online. Now I don't like printing them out because there's a lot of color, but there's some of these where if you want to go print out this map and you've got to plot in some of your artillery fire where you pre-plot it before the other player sets up, you can print these out and just simply take a pencil and go zip, zip, I'm going to fire there and I'm going to fire in that hex. Now, I don't usually do that because I don't know why. I guess I don't want to go through all my printer ink. You will just write down, I'm going to plot it in that zone and that zone. But it's real nice if you want to even plan some stuff. You know, I've got a hidden unit. This is where my hidden unit is, and you write it right on there. Let me walk you through. So when you get into a firefight, you get the history. So it's going to give you the history of the firefight. And it's going to tell you some basic things, how many commanders, who's going to start with initiative, how the VP works, caps, which I'm going to explain in a little bit, are the blue, and APs are the green, and where the caps are going to start. Then it's going to tell you, it shows you and tells you, hey, go get these units. It gives you scenario information, card information, tells you how many rounds there's going to be, reminds you of all your you know, grass, and this one's one AP, palm groves, zero, you can move through them, but it tells you what their defensive value is. So that way, if a scenario needs to be tweaked a little bit, just like it'll tell you if a river's impassable, it's too deep, or you know, you can just wade through it, or can a vehicle go through it. Then it shows you that same map and places the units on the map where you're going to put them. So even though it's very hard to see the number alphanumeric designators, this makes setup very easy, and they're all done that way. This is a high level of detail that makes firefights extremely accessible. It's walking you through your rounds, telling you, you know what, this one's at night. Who's got the initiative? And it just walks through. There's a reinforcement phase. I can't tell you how awesome this is. This is great. And it allows you to really access these scenarios. I want to say there's 12 scenarios. The history that's in here, I just sit and read them and go, oh, God, I want to play that. And when I was playing with my my gamer buddy during this, he's like, oh, I hope they have that. Oh, yeah, they had a 37-millimeter gun and they use canister. And I'm like, really? And then, yep, you go get a card that covers canister. So the level of detail, top-notch, phenomenal, phenomenal. Yes, there's 12 scenarios. All right, you always get two great player aids, and these are a necessity, and they're phenomenal. Tells you your foot movement, track movement. They even got boat movement on here, and then your terrain modifiers for, you know, does it give you extra protection or not? Does it block line of sight? Is it cover? There's little helpful aids that explain things further in the comments. You come over, and it'll walk you through your turn sequence. Gives you a great little reminder for what everything is. And sometimes, like, this means it's turreted. So, you know, I'll be looking and go, man, what's the white circle again? Oh, yeah. You know, it's a, that's my cost there, but it also means turreted. So there's these lovely little reminders on, because the boxes around it do mean something. Just great at-a-glance information. So kind of walks you through everything on your summary sheet. And it wouldn't be if you didn't have a teaser. So here's a little teaser. There's a second printing of Storm of Steel coming. This is Kursk, 1943, Germans and the Russians. The biggest tank battles in history, and they're going to get a second printing. When's it coming? We don't know. We don't know. It'll come when it comes. So then you get your teaser on the other ones. By the way, phenomenal. Oh, it's all good. All right, I know I'm doing a real detailed components walkthrough. I'm going to show gameplay in a second here. This is your tray. For the first time, you got a lid. Now, here's the first thing I noticed. Usually, all these slots are chock full of units. And there's just not as many units. Now, I don't have my army troops out yet. I haven't put them here. I like the added tray with the slots. There's plenty of room for expansions. Something to show you on this one is the... Hello, throwing stuff on the floor. When a unit takes a hit, when they're successfully hit, and I'll get into how that happens, you go draw one of these chits. Now, you can load them up into a cup. You can spread them out on the table. But for the first time, the chits are different. So you can see this is more of the Japanese rising sun. And this has the stars and stripes in there. And you're going to be pulling from different piles depending on who's being attacked. And this is another way they've gotten into the detail. There are some no-hit markers. Matter of fact, there's one right now. There's a total of 5 no-hit markers in here. Now, some scenarios tell you only use 3, pull 2 of them out, or whatever, but it goes to show how fanatical the Japanese could be. They would take lots and lots of wounds, so you would hit this unit, and they go and draw a marker, and, oh, it's a no-hit. And you don't always get to see that right away until, you know, if you hit it a second time, and all of a sudden you're thinking, that unit's dead. No, it's not. This unit won't die. So they've done some things. They got a berserker kind of thing in here. And I'll show you major casualties. I'll show you how these work when I go in and explain the rules. But I love the fact that for the first time, they've got 2 stacks. So you can modify kind of how the different warring factors kind of reacted to things. They still have a separate one also for tanks because there are some tanks in the scenarios. So worth showing you. All right, I'm going to show you something else that's different. These are your sheets that you're going to use to track your caps and your APs. Caps, think of them as your officers and their ability to command. Your APs are just your action points. But for the first time, you'll notice they're slightly different. Usually, you can just hand them out. It doesn't matter who has what. But you're going to notice that the Japanese in this line are tracking Bushido points, where the Americans are tracking victory points. So I'm going to use this sheet to explain how caps work, APs work, and then I'm going to also explain how the Bushido points work. All right, so each player has their sheet. Again, it's going to be based on if you're the Japanese or the Americans. First, just your game round tracker. Some rounds will go all the way to 7. Some are going to stop at 4 anywhere along the way. And a round is basically you're each going to be activating units that are on the map. And if you do not have, once you're done activating a unit, I'll get into that. When they're spent, you flip them over. And if you don't have any more units to activate, you have to pass. Now, you can pass voluntarily as well. You may be wanting a round to get over quicker, or you don't have any unit that could do anything and you pass. Once both players pass, that round's over. You flip all your counters back over. They go over from the spent side on the map back over to their active side. By the way, that is facing. I'll get into these counters in a little bit. And that would then move the round. Bushido. The different scenario will tell you what you need to do to earn Bushido and what can happen to you in order to lose Bushido. And you'll move your Bushido positive as you move up. You'll be on the positive side. If you lose a Bushido, again, it's based on the individual scenario, you'll go down. You can then end up going to the negative side, and it'll come down, and you'll just track it back and forth. For instance, you might have to get across a river, and if you can get a unit across a river, you're going to go up one on the Bushido. It leads to some kind of crazy bonsai charge type stuff. However, if you lose a unit, you're going to go down in Bushido. So, just an example. Again, it's different. Bushido can be different based on the scenario you're in. Now, what does Bushido do as you gain or lose it? Well, it gives you caps. Well, what are caps? Caps are command action points. Think of them as your officers, your leaders. And caps can be used to, there's a whole multitude. You can use them to add action points, which I'll get to in a second. You can use them when you're rolling dice to see if you're going to attack a unit and you want to add a +1 or a +2. You could use 2 caps and up your chance of hit. You have to use them to buy cards. There's just a lot of stuff, not all cards, but there's a lot of stuff you can use caps for. You want caps. So ideally, you keep your Bushido high and in the positive mode, and you're going to get more caps. It's as if your troops are inspired and they're getting, you know, a lot of gung-ho attitude. So they're getting more caps, which is going to allow you to do more things, be more effective, maybe put on a better attack. So this is how caps are going to be used. APs, action points. You're seeing this little deal here. This is the default. This is like the basic entry level, and that's fine. In the basic game, you always have 7 caps, and you will be taking actions with your units. And I'm going to show you one real quick. If I were to move with this unit, it's 1 to move in a, let's just say, this beach zone. That's an open area. It would only cost me 1. However, if I was moving through heavy jungle not only cost me the 1 to move, but a +2 for a total of 3 APs. So if I was moving through heavy jungle, I would have to spend 1, 2, 3. So I've spent 3 APs in order to move this unit through heavy jungle. If I was going to shoot with this unit, I'm looking in this corner, it would cost me 3 APs to shoot. Say, great, okay, so just to shoot is going to cost 3 APs. Now you'll see some units are more efficient on that. Let me go find one real quick. I'll show you this Japanese gun. So it's only going to take this Japanese gun 2. But you can see for movement, it's a lot harder to move that gun around. It's going to cost 3. And if you're moving it through heavy jungle, you're going to add 2. So it's going to be very hard to move that gun through jungle. Yes, it would. Let me show you just another American comparison. I love these paramarines. I'm going to show them to you again in a little bit. They're very effective. It only takes them 2 APs to shoot. However, these Japanese conscripts, I think Koreans in reality, it takes them 4. They're not as well trained. So you can get the idea of what you're going to be using your APs to do. Just a flavor. So you're going to be using them to move and fire generally. There's some stuff I'll get into a little bit later on rallying. Basically, your units are hit, they're scared, or they're been made to put their head down. But I'm going to explain how that works because you're also going to spend APs to rally. So again, you can use command points to augment your APs, to buy cards or to activate certain cards to help you with initiative or to help you when you're attacking. That is how this board will work. Now, what I do is instead of using the default, this comes from the rules. It's not something I made up. Uva has it right in the rules, is you can roll these in a cup. So you're going to secretly roll them in a cup. You roll them out. The rules allow you to simply just roll 2 dice, and that would be your APs. So on that, you activate this unit. You roll 2 dice. Everybody sees it, and you're only going to have 6, and you would move your marker to 6. I should grab a Japanese rifle unit so it makes more. All right, so you would roll, move it. There you go. You could keep that secret, keep that hidden under a cup, and then you count up. But if you're going to do that, I like to means test it. So I will roll. Let me just get them all so they're all the same color. I'll roll 3 dice. They're rolled in a cup. My opponent doesn't see them. You take the high and you take the low. You throw out the middle, and now my APs are 9. And this is hidden. And you don't move it up to 9, you just start taking actions. So this guy, he's on the map, I move him 1. My opponent sees me do that, I move this unit on the map 1. My opponent takes their turn, they do the exact same thing. There's always, both players have an active unit, and I will make an AP move, then they will. Then it's back to me. And this time, I'm going to shoot. So I shoot at the opposing unit, 1, 2, 3. I'm going to add 2 to my caps. And when I shoot at another unit, let's say I'm shooting at this American unit. All right. They're head to head. Let's say they're 3 hexes away from each other. There's a couple things you're looking at. Number 1, range. So this guy can shoot 5. This American could shoot 7 hexes. So are they within range? Yes, 3 hexes away. So it's going to cost me 3 to shoot. And this is the number I'm going to get to add to my die roll. So I'm going to come in and roll 2 dice. And I'm going to try to hit this unit. Now you're asking, well, how do you hit a unit? All right. Well, if I'm facing him, which I am, let's just assume we're facing each other direct on 3 hexes away. If I'm facing the unit, you look down here to see what I need to roll. I either need to equal or exceed. If I'm on the flank, which is behind or to the side of this unit, I only need an 11. So you can see the Americans, more well-trained or better equipped, they've got a little bit higher value if they're attacked from the rear, from their flank, than the Japanese do. So I get a +4 to this die roll. I added 2 caps. I roll. I've got a pure 10. It's phenomenal. And I'm going to add 6 to it because I'm adding the 4 plus the 2 caps. So I end up with 16. All I needed to do was to get a 12 in order to hit this unit. So I've hit it. And it's a critical hit if you ever exceed that number by 4. Let me explain what a regular hit would be. That's a great roll. Great roll. So a regular hit, let's just say I got the 12. I got the pure 12. I would reach out, I would grab a token, one of these hit tokens out of a cup, and I would only look at it myself. And you're saying, well, what does cower mean and what are all these numbers? Well, let me grab my unit. Where did I put it? Way over there. So if I grab this unit, everything's positioned the same way. All right, so I'm the only one that can see this, but I now know that this unit now, he's got to add two if he ever wants to shoot. So it's going to cost this American unit, if he wants to shoot, five APs, not three, but five, because he's cowering. If he decides he wants to move, it doesn't cost him one anymore, costs him two. Now, there's some cool effects for him. Well, this is bad. His range just went from 7 to 1. All right, he's laying down, he's face planted, he can't shoot 7 hexes anymore. He can only shoot one away. But he's getting plus modifiers. So now in order to hit him, the Japanese would need to get 13 or they would need to get 12. They've gone to ground facing the dirt. They're actually harder to hit. So then we have the rally. Rally is if this unit was hit and he drew this card, this tile, in order to get this marker off of him with all these bad effects, he's got to spend 5 APs or 5 caps, any combination thereof, and then he's got to roll 2 dice, and you've got to equal or exceed the rally number. Now, again, you could add a cap to it, or sometimes cover might come in and help you as well, but he's got to get 9 or better on a 2-die roll, and if he does, he rallies, and this comes off. This is huge, because this is on you, right? Now, the opponent won't know exactly what is on you unless you try to do something. If I were to shoot, I've got to flip it over and let them know, hey, here's all the penalties that I'm shooting. And now they know, oh, that unit's cowering. Or maybe they shoot at this unit and they think they hit it. And I'm like, actually, you didn't. It's harder to hit. But if you've got one of these wound markers on you and you get a second one, the unit's eliminated. They're combat ineffective. So now for the Japanese, that can be a little bit different because they have some no-hit markers. So you think you've hit them twice and you haven't. Real quick, let me show a couple comparison units. Let me see, where did that, there we go. So you've got your American or your Marine rifle and your Japanese. You can see they're fairly comparable. Actually, a little bit better die modifier, a little bit better range and defense for the American. The two medium MGs, again, almost identical, but it's a little easier for the Americans to move. That medium MG would pick up and break down a lot easier. So that's modified in here, shown. The range, however, of the Japanese gun, you can see, much better. And I've got a heavy MG. This is really in a comparison, but I wanted to show them. So the Japanese had these little lighter MGs. Almost like a Bren that they could pick up and move around. So you can see even the difference there and the difference with the American's medium machine gun compared to the heavy. The range, everything's a lot heavier to move around, but the range is much further on that heavy. It was water cooled. Japanese got a couple different, you got your conscripts and you've got snipers. Let me show you, I love the paramarines. They carried a lot of Thompsons, a lot of carbines. They have very poor range. Cheap to shoot, only cost 2 APs, quick to move, a lot of damage, but they just don't have the range. They've got to close in. But you can also see, doesn't matter if you're shooting at their flank, their rear, or their front, they're tough either way. Whereas you can see the conscripts, not so much. Snipers kind of got that same ability. Great range. All right, going to fly through real quick. I'm going to show you these mortars. So you got 81 millimeter mortars. Both of them got them. This is indirect fire. So if the mortar can't see the unit, there's no direct line of sight. They can still fire, but it's more expensive. You can see their ranges here. 3 to 18, 3 to 16. so they're not going to be engaging anybody that gets into close combat with them. Charge down on your mortars. Don't let them just plink away at you from a distance. Also, the Marines do have a BAR unit. See if I can, is that the, no, paramarine. Here we go. You can see how BAR just slightly more effective on range and to hit with that automatic 30-06. All right, Japanese got 2 tanks. I like to get them on there. Now you're saying, what is this? This is a bonus movement if they're moving on a road or in a clear area. So they can really get rolling. Obviously, they don't get that if they're in jungle or anywhere where it's a lot harder to move. But if they're out in the open, they can really get going. So cheap to move, a little bit. That means they're turreted, a little bit more expensive to shoot. You can see which one's a little stronger. So this one's a little bit better against tanks. This one's better against infantry. And you can see who's got the better armor, front and rear, front and rear. So, and let me show you, the Americans have a little half track with a howitzer on it, which is interesting, a little bit faster, and they got their little Stuart. And just for that comparison value, let me get the bigger tank, but you can get a feel for that. So first of all, if you're playing, it's fine to learn if you use the basic AP setup that I kind of showed you in there, but I'm telling you, means test your dice. Do the thing with the three dice. You roll it, the high and the low, throughout the middle. If you do that, you get a pretty good standard run. Although I rolled three snake eyes once. Oh, just like 2 days ago. And I couldn't even shoot. I was like, oh, come on. It was my mortar team. They couldn't see. Took four. Oh, all right. But that's what I love about it. All right, so means test your dice. Keep that hidden information, count your APs up. And then when you can't do anything more or you exhaust that unit, you just kind of show your dice, trust but verify kind of deal. Right? It shines. That's the, as far as I'm concerned, that's the only way you can play this. So, specific game, specific Guadalcanal game. I'm going to start with something I don't like so much. The maps are gorgeous, just beautiful, but I can't make out the hexes too well. You know, they've gone, I showed you in that closer look with those little kind of subdued hexes. Everything's a little bit darker. And even when they were in some of the clear spots when I'm playing, I was having to really get square over the top. And the guy I was playing was like, hey, you're moving outside your hex there. You're actually over here. So the maps look gorgeous, but they lost a little bit of functionality here. And I'm not sure, you know, sometimes you can't even see the dot, and the dot's your center point reference for the hex, but you don't want white dots all over the place either. So I don't know. I almost think that maybe the hex lines needed to be lightened up just a little bit, but that is a tricky, tricky thing. A long time ago, I think I know the publisher, but I can't remember for sure, but they put out a war game where the hex grids were white and it looked like you were playing a map with chicken wire over it. It was so distracting, I couldn't play the game. I mean, it was horrible, and they were nice maps. So it's a tricky thing. In multiple plays, I had a lot of eye strain the first time I played. I was just like, wow, I was really struggling with seeing where the guys were supposed to be moving. All right, so that being said, it is what it is. The maps are still gorgeous, lost a little bit of functionality. How did the Japanese feel? Because that's the hardest thing with a World War II Pacific tactical game. The Japanese used some... Historically, the tactics of the bonsai charge, when you generally play a war game, nobody wants to do that because you're just going to get your forces chewed up. You don't charge into machine guns. You just get wasted. So in this game, Academy Games used Bushido points. Bushido points can be different things. Well, you get them and lose them different ways based on the scenario. I'm going to come back to that. Let me explain those. And I know I showed you Bushido points, so I'll gloss over it a little bit. Basically, they get you caps or they lose you caps. The different scenarios and how you gain and lose Bushido points give you the feel and the historical style of what happened in those individual firefights. Awesome. We experienced that in all the games we played. Even in the intro, and Bubs Bryant, a guy I play with, loves history, and we're playing the firefight, and he's telling me about, oh, this is how it really went, this is what the thing is, and this is the deal here, and the squad was ambushed, and he knew all this stuff. He knew out of the scenarios we played, he like knew them all well. And I was like, wow, you know, I didn't know that kind of detail at all. And he's like, oh yeah. So I don't know if he's an expert on Guadalcanal or just that history or what, but he was all over it. And the ambush is played as they should. I had troops that were on a timeline that had to get back to a patrol boat to get off the beach. I'm running behind. I've got guys moving into close combat to engage machine guns so they can't fire on anybody else, but it's a sacrifice because those guys aren't going to get out there. I got a troops just flat out running and they're getting shot at. I mean, it was the thematic pictures in my mind are what make Conflict of Heroes, the system, my favorite system. It paints this narrative as you play that it just lends itself so well to the historical nature and the gameplay. And those Bushido points, Bubs is playing the Japanese. He's got to push past this river. His troops are piddling in, simulating that it was an uncoordinated attack with tanks and troops, and the troops got slowed down in the jungle. And they're coming on, and little bits here, and then little bits here. The tanks can overpower me, but I, as the Marines, had artillery coming in as well, bunkered up 37 millimeter anti-tank gun. I mean, the tension was just there, and he had to really sprint for this river and get across the river, and I'm just hoping my shelling's going to be effective, and it was. So he had me on the ropes, and I won't go into the whole scenario, but I was my artillery came in and saved me. But again, the narrative feel, I did not think I was going to win this. We're engaged. He presses with a tank. I can't stop it. I can't get a shot on it. I get an artillery hit on it. Does nothing. Means an artillery hit in that zone, so it didn't hit the tank. Oh my goodness. So I'm going to tell you, the flavor of this game is Pacific. The Japanese are modeled beautifully. The desperation of the objectives and how the Bushido points work. And as, because you can take the Japanese player negative Bushido and they're losing caps, or positive and they're gaining caps. The use of the cards, again, I mean, the cards are always good in the Conflict of Heroes system, but they're great here as well. So if you like Conflict of Heroes, I think it's a must buy. I mean, they're going into the Pacific. If you have never played Conflict of Heroes and you want to try a tactical system in the Pacific with the Japanese and the Marines, I think this is a great one for tactical, because you're actually going to model some of the things that happened. On a side note, when I did the unboxing, I had one commenter that thought I wasn't objective enough. Now, I'll tell you flat out, this is my favorite system. That being said, did it hold up as my favorite system? Yes. Objectively, yes. The maps are gorgeous, but they failed a little bit on their clarity. And I think the maps have to be easy to see. Bubs, who I'm playing, is older than me, and you know, I almost felt like I needed a big magnifying glass. But the commenter was more concerned with Academy Games than this game. And that's what I posted back, was it seems like he wanted a review of Academy Games, the company, rather than the board game. And his issue was that this game had been teased maybe since 2009, kind of put on, hey, you'll get it next year, hey, you'll get it next year. And yeah, that got me too. I kept getting real excited and then nothing, real excited and nothing. I'll be honest with you. At some point, I just thought, I hope it comes out. I hope they support the system. I wish they put a Conflict of Heroes game out every year. Academy Games has not. But they're a successful company that's putting out some phenomenal games. I like the other stuff they do too. I just did Mare Nostrum. Love it. Love it. So, objectively, Academy Games, keep doing what you're doing. Fantasy Flight may have an idea where they don't tell you what's coming out, boom, until it's all ready to go, packaged, and it's hitting Gen Con in 3 weeks, and then everybody goes nuts. It's probably the best way to do it, because if it's not ready, it's not ready. Nobody knows. Nobody's feelings get hurt. I don't know. My feelings don't really get hurt. I would love the other ones to come. They've teased like the 1940 scenario. They teased an airborne, the Normandy invasion. I can't remember the name of it. But those are teasers to me. I don't really expect anything until they're saying, hey, they're going to the printer. I mean, look how everybody treats Kickstarters. You realize what's involved, and that's when they've got the money up front. This wasn't kickstarted. So I'm very flexible on that. Maybe that's just me. When a game becomes live, or I start getting excited when I check in with the publisher and they say it's gone to print. And when they say it's being printed right now, I still know, you know, we could have some problems. We could be a ways out. But that's when I start to get excited. Everything else to me is like, you know, potential. My two cents, I felt that needed to be addressed just because of the way it came up. And I do see a lot of comments in general forums and things on BGG where people feel like, hey, the system isn't supported enough, and they say they've gone to a different system. Okay, all right. That's it. Chief, bonding with board games, Academy Games, Conflict of Heroes, Guadalcanal. By the way, there's a lot of room in there for extra units. I think there should be a way to slide in some more units, or not, I don't know. Maybe we don't need them. The tray's big, a lot of room. See you guys. Bye.